is Lynn from wisconsingarden.com, and I'm kind of competing with our neighbor who was chopping up some trees that they cut down the other day.
Well, we're going to be planting trees.
We are. A couple years back we had to take some down, and we haven't stopped planting since. And when the rabbits ruined and chewed off our poor little honey crisp apple trees that we planted last year, we started looking at apple trees and got carried away again. So there will be at least six. We're planting six apple trees of different varieties around the yard. This one we just kind of found at our local Menards, which is like a local Home Depot. Started in Wisconsin, and they now have several stores around the state. When we told them we were looking for Honeycrisp apple trees and we wanted the dwarf ones, smaller, we didn't want a huge tree, they said, oh, you have to see these. These are a new thing that just came in. They're called twisted apple trees. So it's two different varieties of apple trees that are twisted together from birth or shortly thereafter. So you get, on this one, you get a Fuji and a Harrelson, and they are just twisted together, so they pollinate each other. So if you don't have any apple trees in your neighborhood, this would be all you'd need.
And why are you taking this apart?
Well, I don't think this is supposed to be on here permanently. I think it was just a shipping protection. And I want to see how big the actual trees are.
Well, down here they look like they're maybe 3/4 of an inch at this point, at best. Looks like they just use a felt material.
It feels like felt paper.
Yeah.
Okay, so all they are is two trees twisted together, like they said, probably since their babyhood.
Young saplings.
And eventually, they will have to be unbound because, I mean, think of an apple tree. It's going to be that big. So somehow you have to keep them growing together.
I'm sure you just have to keep changing the ties.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even using a nylon, you know, something that would expand.
Something stretchy, yes.
But still hold them in place.
Right.
And then maybe every year you adjust it.
Cool idea.
Yeah.
These particular ones are going to get, how tall are they going to get?
I thought they were about 16 feet.
Yeah. 15 to 16 feet tall. So you've got nice, plenty of sunshine right here. And then this one over here, is a Honeycrisp Macintosh. And that's how they look when you take the wrapping off. So they definitely have been trimmed, but they've been trained since they were little to grow together.
Kind of like the opposite of a bonsai, you know, where you're just controlling their growth as they start sprouting up from saplings.
Yep. So we're looking forward to these. See what happens with them.
Well, the concept that I thought of self-pollinating, you know,
that's
having
good.
Them right together. I mean, wow, that's
right,
perfect.
That, you can't get any closer than that, so.
Now, this all started because of the rabbits eating our two apple,
honey crisp.
I keep calling it apple crisp.
You have that in your mind.
I just
want apple crisp.
Yeah.
Right. Well, they got at our trees because we had only wrapped them about 2 feet this fall. We wrapped them 2 feet thinking that would be plenty to protect them from rabbits, but oh no, we had at least 2 feet of snow on the ground, so anything that wasn't protected, snow level and above, were chewed down and ruined, as we talked about in a past video. So these we will have to really protect next year and keep those little nasty rabbits away from them. Although someone, one of my viewers, who was very smart and more positive thinking than me, said, well, just think of all the fertilizing that they did for you.
Yeah.
Which is true. Thank you for that comment.
Well, this all started with the two we have up in the gazebo. Let's go take a look at those.
And our hunt for these apple trees, because we were after the Honeycrisp, led us back to Home Depot where we originally found them. And sure enough, we found two more dwarf Honeycrisp. And that was wonderful because this is about the size our other ones were last year before they got chewed off. But we'd also been thinking for a couple of years that at the end of the driveway we would like to have matching trees. We thought flowering trees of some kind would be good, but we couldn't find two that matched that we liked and wouldn't be too difficult to see past when we were trying to drive in and out of the driveway. And then we saw these little dwarf Macintosh apples. So instead of just having flowering trees in the spring, we are now going to have flowering trees that will have Macintosh apples in the fall. So we are on the path to the high school, so I'm guessing there may be a few that'll be missing come fall, but that's okay. We love to share.
Well, then I also noticed we picked up some additional bulbs and...
You noticed that?
Yeah.
You put them in the cart.
Well,
okay, so we have gladiolas, which are your favorite.
I can't say they're my favorite, but I really like
you
them.
You like them, yes, you and Sky both.
And I think my sister, she loves gladiolas, so this is in honor of Barbara.
Okay.
So Barbara, if you're watching, these are for you.
You'll have to come visit them.
Yes.
This, I believe, is a variety of Coral Bell.
It really struck me, that leaf structure. I hadn't seen that locally with the Coral Bells that we have, anyhow, or that were available, so that kind of attracted me.
And then we found some daylilies that were very exotic looking.
Ah, those are cool.
And I just remembered we bought these lilies, I think at Aldi's. So, depending on where we are, we just can't help ourselves and we keep looking. And sure enough, we always find something. But we're going to be doing a new flower bed over on the far end of the property where there were tiger lilies growing.
So the north garden?
We're taking the northeast corner. We're going to take out the tiger lilies that are there and we're going to be planting some other perennials instead. Then, of course, we start looking because the rabbits ate a lot of our raspberries. And all of a sudden, Rick said, hey, look, there's goji berries. Maybe we should get some of those. So we've never tried those before. They say they're going to be hardy enough to live in Wisconsin. So we'll see. They're supposed to be very, very good for you. And then I always wanted some golden raspberries. We have two varieties of those. Oh, no, those are the same. Raspberries, and we can't help ourselves when it comes to blueberries. And the rabbits were also very busy on our blackberries, so we got the thornless blackberries.
Well, we have one really nice blackberry bush growing that just was very prolific.
Oh my, it was.
I mean, it kind of amazed me at how it actually started invading the raspberry.
Yes, it intertwined itself. We couldn't even see the branches going out because it was just so prolific, but that was fine. And but again, we don't know how much damage has truly been done to it, so we'll just plant some extras in case.
Now I noticed you brought a lot of perlite this year.
I did. In our flower beds to where we've had the tomatoes for a couple of years now, and we have to start rotating. But we noticed that the beds now, we probably have too much sand in there and not enough actual substance to the soil. And while we're going to be adding compost again, and we've got lots of leaf mulch in there, we're going to be adding some perlite in there also, just to keep the soil tillable and also help with keeping some of the moisture in, perhaps.
Well, they use it for indoor plants. I mean, you see that a lot.
Any plant you buy in the store will have perlite or vermiculite mixed in.
Now, remember when you did your African violets, you put it in a, I don't want to say perlite soil, but you didn't use a...
Pretty much. It was, well, when I was starting them, I wanted not just to have water in there because I wanted them to develop soil roots instead of just water roots. So I mixed water and perlite together, which kept it nice and loose so the roots could develop, but at the same time allowed it to develop those earth roots, the soil roots. And it worked really well.
Have you experimented with this and just, let's say, growing seeds in perlite?
No, I haven't, but I know I've mixed it half and half.
Right, I've seen that.
Soil.
In your soil mix.
Right, and half perlite, so.
It might be interesting to do a little experiment. I thought I saw one of our viewers send us a picture of their peony trees, and it almost looked as if they had them in these tubs of perlite, and they were doing marvelous.
Yes, that is Joseph from Hungary. He was showing us two pictures of his peony tree seedlings that were coming up, and Joseph, if we're wrong, please let us know, but it looked like he was growing them only in perlite, although maybe he just had the soil mixed underneath it, but they sure were doing well.
They sure were.
We were jealous.
Yeah. Okay, so next comes planting the trees, and as a guide, you always make sure that your hole is twice as big.
Right. So for this pot, let's say, the pot itself is this big, and the hole is going to have to be twice as big as the pot, and twice as deep, two times as deep.
Yeah, but you don't bury the root ball.
No, you don't. No, and if anything, you want the top of the soil that you're planting. Let me just show this. So when we're planting this, you want the top of this, and this is where the graft on this one is, so the graft cannot be below the soil anyway, but you would want the soil to be right about there where it is in the pot. But underneath this, so my hole is twice this deep, I'm going to refill it with loosened soil and maybe some perlite and some worm castings or some compost in the bottom of the hole and bring it up to the right level. But that way it'll give the roots a nice easy way to get down into the soil and get a good anchor going. Well, we have our work cut out for us because we're going to be planting all of these pretty much, except maybe the goji berries and although the raspberries are coming up by themselves already, so maybe those too. Another thing we were planning on doing is using the dormant oil spray only on the established fruit trees. This is something you do before the trees bud out in the spring. You can do it from November through April or until the budding occurs. I'm guessing these are too far along actually to spray these.
And yeah, but if you gave it a light spray, I bet it wouldn't...
Maybe.
Yeah.
But we decided we weren't going to spray these plants because they're going to be stressed when we replant them.
We're not spraying this year.
No, not this year. So we don't want to spray these because of their moving around and getting replanted. But we do have a cherry tree, a plum tree, pear trees, the peach trees, and our huge apple tree that we had from last year. We are going to get those before it gets too much farther into the season.
And you don't want to spray those if you know it's going to rain.
Right. If it's windy, because your spray will go everywhere. And it's mostly what it is mineral oil, and you're going to end up an oily mess yourself. Then I started doing some research after we had bought this at the store, and a different variety you can make at home is by using very fine canola oil, 2 tablespoons and 1 tablespoon of baking soda in 1 gallon of water to spray. Make sure you shake it up really well. So that, again, that's 2 tablespoons of very fine canola oil, 1 tablespoon of baking soda in a gallon of water. Shake it up really well, and then you can spray that on.
Why do I feel I'm in the Godfather movie? Monday,
boy.
Tuesday, Thursday, Wednesday.
And again, we're not going to be spraying these, and you don't want to spray it when they have budded out. So your time is right now, this time of year, it's getting a little late.
Well, again, for our viewers who ask where do we get those dwarf Honeycrisp, this is the time you should be looking, because mm-hmm. they don't last very long once they're out and the public starts seeing them. So
right.
keep your eyes open now. Go
yep.
to your local garden center. If
right.
you do have a Home Depot in your area.
Or definitely, Walmart.
Or Walmart.
Walmart yep. has fruit trees, and we have, I believe we got our peaches
Our
there.
Peach trees came from
right.
there, and boy, that surprised the heck out of us when we saw them there.
Right. So just keep your eyes open, and little nurseries may have ordered them also. Thank you so much for watching, and give us a thumbs up if you have a chance, and if you learned something or enjoyed our video, and we would love to hear comments from you. Thank you for everybody that's been sending comments and helpful tips and questions that I hope I've been able to answer adequately, and we would love to have you subscribe.
Well, understand, you're now getting probably between 3,000 and 5,000 viewers a day. And out of that, you're probably getting hundreds, well, I just looked, almost 1,000 new subscribers just in the last 30 days.
Thanks, guys.
And think of all the comments that have come your way. I mean, I feel them and send them to you. I'm probably sending you probably 50 to 75 every single day.
Well,
so I hope people are patient with us and understand that we created a monster. But I've got something.
Love it.
Oh, we do love it. But I've got something that may just be what we're going to be producing in the future. I think we're going to be producing live webinars where people will announce the date and time and where to go, and people will be able to log on and ask their questions and listen to everybody else's question and just have a
Help
good old time.
Answer the questions.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, that's something else we have in the works this year, along with our vertical gardens. So, again, thanks for watching, and keep those comments coming.
Thanks, everybody.